Good morning, students. Today we will be starting off with the next poem in English. It is a very beautiful poem that has a universal appeal. It is a very classic poem written by William Shakespeare. I'll share the screen with you. The name of the poem is All the World's a Stage. This poem is written by William Shakespeare. William Shakespeare was one of the most famous poet of the Elizabethan era. And he lived from 1564 to 1616 children. He is an English poet, playwright and actor. And he is considered to be the greatest writer in English language and world's prominent dramatist. He has written several dramas. And therefore, he's often called as England's national poet and the Bard of Avon. The poem which is there in your textbook, All the World's a Stage, is taken from his play As You Like It. And in this poem, the poet compares the world to a stage where the drama of human life is enacted. Let us go ahead. Shakespeare here metaphorically calls the earth as a stage because our earth looks like a stage and all its inhabitants, that is we, the human beings who live here, we all are like actors who play different roles. Man's birth on the earth is considered to be an entry on the stage and his death is the exit. In between, in the journey of life, he plays seven roles. And these seven roles are well described with all its unique characteristic features by William Wordsworth. All the Words, William Shakespeare. All the World's a Stage is a monologue, a particular character from the play, As You Like It. He has narrated this particular poem. Let's go ahead. The seven ages of man, or the seven stages as you call it. Here you have a beautiful, very beautiful image where first as an infant, then as a school going child, then as a teenager, an adult person, then a middle-aged person, and slowly moving to the old age or the last stage of life. Let's go ahead. Here there's another one image which again tells us about the seven ages of man. A helpless infant, a whining schoolboy, then you have an enthusiastic lover, then a devoted soldier, then you have a wise judge or a wise man with all his wisdom and knowledge that and experiences he has gathered in his lifetime. And finally, the clueless old man who is totally helpless and dependent on others. And the last stage where a man has to exit from the world, he becomes a corpse or he dies. The poet describes the seven stages of man's life. Each stage of life has its own unique characteristic features. We'll read the poem and bit by bit, every stage I'll explain it to you and also deal with the figures of speech that is present in that particular part. All the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. And one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. So the entire life story is divided into seven stages, children. And men and women are compared to players or actors. Everyone has a role to play. Where do they play this role? In the stage, that is the world stage. The exits and entrances. Exit is the death and entrances the birth. Now the figure of speech used in these four lines, there is an indirect comparison, children. It's an extended metaphor. The word like or as is not used, but at the same time a comparison is made. The world is compared to a stage. Men and women are compared to actors and actresses. entry is birth and exit is death. So there's a very beautiful comparison, and this particular lines written by Shakespeare is applicable to every human being. So it has universal application, children. It's a classic poem because it will hold good for times to come. Now, going back a little bit to the activity which is present before we actually begin the poem. Okay, the second stanza, the second part of the poem. You have matched the column appropriate ages with the stages. Birth to 2 years is called as childhood. 2 to 3 years to 12 years is called a teenage or a adolescent. 13 to 17 years. Birth to 2 years is called as babyhood or infancy. 3 to 12 years you have childhood. 13 to 17 years is teenage or adolescence. Then 18 years to 44 years will be the middle age. 45 to 60 years you have the adulthood. Then 65 up to 75, 80 years is a senior citizen or the elderly person. Okay. Above 80 years, you have the old age or the second childhood. Okay, let's move ahead with the poem. At first, the infant, Shakespeare describes the first stage. At first, the infant, a very small baby, a very young child, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. Birth marks the first the entry of the first stage of life. And this particular child, an infant, a young baby, is in the nurse's or the mother's arms and is helpless. What do? All the time they are crying. They cry, they communicate through their cries, and vomiting, puking is very common. And babies do almost nothing throughout the day other than mewling, that is crying, and spitting up after every feed. So Shakespeare describes this first stage of life marked by these two activities, where a child is constantly crying, or what he's doing, he is vomiting or puking. So two words are used by him, mewling and puking. The second stage, after when he grows up, the second stage, he is a whining schoolboy. And then the whining schoolboy with his satchel is a school bag with a back strap and the shining morning face, creeping is moving very slowly like snail, unwilling to school. Is he willing to go to school? No, unwilling to go to school. At this stage, what happens? The infancy stage, the childhood stage is actually over. And his in carefree days where he was very free, nothing, he had nothing else to do. That stage where he used to always play, that stage is over. And while he's at school, he's introduced to the world of discipline, order, routine. There are school rules to be followed. His playing time gets restricted, and that is why naturally a child starts complaining, whining and complaining about the forced routine that he has to follow. And in Shakespeare's time, children, school was a very forced practice, and the schools were usually run by the church. And depending on the status of a parent, a child went either to a grammar school or a monastic school that is run by the church. And school began at sunrise and lasted the whole day. Punishments were very severe, very harsh. And therefore, the children never used to love going to the school. So here, Shakespeare describes the boy as creeping slowly, moving slowly like a snail, unwilling to go to school. So what is a figure of speech that the poet has used here? Whining is long, high-pitched, complaining cry. So what does the boy complain about? His going to the, his unwillingness to go to the school. Okay, again, then the whining schoolboy with his satchel. Whining again reflects the sound of the complaining sound made by the small young boy. So onomatopoeia, sound is indicated by the word whining. Again, you have, there is a comparison made here, children. Okay. Like creeping like snail, like word is used, and when the words like and as is used for comparison, it's the simile. It is a simile. Comparison of a schoolboy's movement to that of a snail. Okay. Inversion, unwilling to school. He goes unwilling to school, creeping like a snail to to school unwillingly. It should have been that way. But then again, here it's in inversion. Words are not in proper prose order. So you have inversion, another figure of speech. So lots of figures of speech are used by the poet in order to make the poem really very effective. Coming to the third stage, here it's a teenager. And what is the main thing that a teenager does? The teenager during this time, during Shakespeare's time, teenagers were more interested in having girlfriends. And so therefore here he continues. And then the lover, sighing like a furnace with a woeful ballad made to his mistress eyebrow. What does the teenager do? He is moved by the beauty of his beloved or his girlfriend. And so therefore he becomes a poet. Okay. So he tries to compose poems. He writes elaborate verses about the beauty of his beloved. And so he is disappointed because he's not able to spend a lot of time in that particular lover's company. So he keeps sighing. That is, he takes deep breath to express his sorrow or dissatisfaction. Who's a mistress here? Mistress word is used for beloved. Okay. How does he sigh? Like a furnace, because he is filled with so much of emotions. Okay. That a furnace is an enclosed structure where metals are heated. So he is like a lot of emotions are there in him and he's not able to bring them out properly. So therefore he's like a furnace. And what kind of feelings are there? Woeful. That is, he is expressing his sorrow or sadness that he is not able to enjoy her company. Again, the figures of speech here, children. The lover sighing like furnace with a woeful ballad. Simile, lover is compared to a furnace. Made to his mistress eyebrow. Alliteration, sound of the letter M, made M and mistress M. Sound of the letter M is repeated. With a woeful ballad, woeful, sorrowful. Ballad is a song which is written, a long song, generally which has the element of which, the theme of which is sad, is called a ballad. So here it is transferred epithet, another figure of speech. Epithet stands for adjective, children. Okay, so what is sorrowful? It is, what is woeful? It is not the ballad which is woeful. It is the person who is full of sorrow. So therefore, the adjective woeful is transferred from the person and is placed in front of ballad to which it has no connection. So we say the adjective is transferred. So transferred epithet. The person is woeful and not the ballad. So we have completed three important stages, children. The first stage, which is marked by two important actions, that is the infant mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. The second one is the young schoolboy whose face is shines, but then who is unwilling to go to school. Therefore, he moves very slowly like the snail, creeping. Okay, he creeps slowly like the snail when he has to go to the school. So the school days or the childhood days when one is forced to spend most of his time in the school. The third one, the third stage, the teenager stage, where he is like he's a lover, and his attention that is more towards his interests are more towards gaining the attention of the other gender, and so therefore he is more interested in expressing his love and trying to please or trying to look beautiful and be well dressed and try to attract attention of the opposite sex. The fourth stage is that of a soldier. Now he becomes a little more serious in life. Are kuch karna hai life mein mujhe. Okay. So therefore, then a soldier full of strange oaths and bearded like a pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. So now he becomes very serious. Okay. And he wants to do something in life. In those days, lots of young men, to show their power and to show their, they were young, enthusiastic, they were courageous. And therefore, many of them would enroll themselves in the army. And enrolling in themselves in the army, that would give them a reputation. They would become famous. They would earn a name. And another one thing is, there would be, that is, since they were very young, enthusiastic at that time, they would be full of strange oaths. They would pledge to even give up their life for the sake of their country. Bearded like a pard, he compares him, compares this young, angry young man to that of a leopard. Leopard is very swift, very quick. So therefore, he's very quick, quick to pick up coral. And also, he's jealous of his other mates who are more, if they happen to earn a little more fame or name or reputation, then he is jealous of them. That is, there is envy, there is competition. And so he wants to do better. He wants to prove himself that he can do something in life. But how does Shakespeare describe this reputation? He calls it as bubble. He describes it as bubble reputation. A bubble is short-lived. It doesn't last for a long time. Similarly, man's name, fame, wealth, whatever other whatever he reputation he earns over a period of time, he builds up in his career. Sometimes it is, many times it doesn't last for a long time. And how is the soldier's life? All the while he has to face the dangers of life, that is even in the cannon's mouth. Although he knows that leading the life of a soldier, any day his life may end. That is, there is always danger. And so therefore, even when he's facing death, he is quick, he's short-tempered, and he is jealous of the others who are in competition with him. And even when he knows that his life is short-lived and there is no guarantee that he may live for a long period of time, he wants to be famous, and he takes oath, and he is very quick and very, very sudden and quick in quarrel. Very quickly he picks up quarrel because he is enthusiastic about doing a lot of things. Okay, and young soldier, that is in this particular age, everybody has is they have an attitude of brash courage. They are short tempered. They are rebellious by nature. Kuch kar dikhana hai. Even the youth of today, they have that same zeal and enthusiasm. Okay. And when it comes to their rights, they are very assertive during this particular period of time. And many times nowadays they don't enlist themselves in the army. But yet when it comes to fighting for certain social causes, collecting everyone through social media, expressing their viewpoints vocally, and they are very clear about it. And so they are very courageous. The next stage is the middle age. Then the justice in the fair round belly, with good cap unlined, with eyes severe and beard of formal cut, full of wise sauce and modern instances. Okay, here he compares the middle-aged man to a judge. And whenever we talk about a judge, you know, we remember this Jolly LLB, where, you know, this fellow played the role of a judge. Okay, how is he? He's very serious and always fond of eating, and but the decision that he renders at the last minute, you know, really shows that his experiences in life makes him he becomes wise. And then the justice in fair round belly, overeating. He has not taken care of his health. When he reaches middle age, he is he has a lot of fat, and he is he's round, fair and round belly, and excess of fat has accumulated in his body. But how is he? He has become intelligent. Okay, he gives several examples when he talks, showing off his intelligence. So in middle age, over a period of time, nothing has changed. Even a middle-aged person, even today, is the same. Men and women during this middle age, children settle down, they have kids, they have family. They're more interested in building up their career, and they get sidelined, and career becomes more important. But how's a person when it comes to his wisdom? With age, there is wisdom, maturity, and he accepts the realities or the practical realities of life. Idealistic values are pushed behind. He learns that practical considerations becomes very important, and he gives more importance to the professional interest. And now today, However, middle age is slightly different, where even during middle age, we still begin a new career and we go ahead. But that was not so in the times of Shakespeare. So therefore, it is a particular time period when man used to compromise with whatever he had got and he would adjust to the realities of life. The next stage is the sixth stage, where man becomes, he starts showing signs of becoming old. Okay. And the sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon with spectacles on nose and pouch on side. Excess of fat has got accumulated. Okay. And slowly he has started losing his teeth and his eyesight becomes poor. So he has got spectacles. His youthful hose well saved a world too wide. Okay. So therefore, during the time of Shakespeare, one of the, the clothing was tight leggings were worn by the youth. And this, the old, the middle-aged person has saved from his youthful times. And now he, when he tries to fit into it, he's not able to get into it. And now his body has become lean and he doesn't fit into that particular clothing. And shank, part between the leg and the knee and the ankle, it shows that he is his body has started becoming weak. Into the lean and slippered pantaloon, again here is a figure of speech, it's a transferred epithet. Who is lean? It is not the pantaloon that is the loose close fitting leggings, that is not lean. It is the man who has become lean. His physical stature has started becoming, his body has started shrinking, children. And so therefore he started becoming old. So it's a transferred epithet. Let's go ahead. So we finished with the first stage, infancy. Second stage is infancy, first stage, where there are two activities predominant. One is mewling and puking, all the while crying and throwing out or vomiting. The second stage, a childhood where he's unwilling to go to school and therefore he creeps slowly, moves like a snail. And the third stage, where he's like a lover and he expresses his love and affection by writing very beautiful poems for his beloved. The fourth stage is he becomes very serious in life and he's like a soldier, enrolls himself in the army, wants to do great things, wants to have earn name, fame and have a reputation. The fifth stage is where he becomes a little serious and he becomes serious about he no longer takes care of his health and therefore he puts on a lot of weight, excess fat builds up but now he has become intelligent and when he talks, he quotes or gives examples and it shows that he has become wise. His experience teaches him or it makes him a much matured individual. Okay, and then you have the next stage, that's the old age, where slowly his skin has started sagging and he doesn't fit into his youthful clothing. Again, body has started shrinking a little bit and his eyesight has become poor, so he has to depend on his spectacles. Okay, now when it comes to old age during the time, during Shakespeare's time, 40 was considered to be old, and a person, if he would live up to 50, would consider himself to be really lucky because lifespan was comparatively very short, children. Okay, and majority of the people belong to the either middle class or the lower middle class, and so therefore, old age could be very harsh. But people who were old were respected for their wisdom and experience, and many of them, however, suffered due to neglect and degeneration of their physical and mental faculties. That means they were not taken care of. And after a certain age, that is after 40, 50, they would become more religious and their focus would shift from the household chores and the other professional matters to more religious matters. Okay. But however, today, at 40, 50, people are still very young, enthusiastic, pursuing goals. They go back to their hobbies and they make good retirement plans at 40, so that by the time they retire at around 50, 50, 58, they have good amount of, they're financially very comfortable and they can lead a lead a comfortable life. Okay, so today it is not so uncommon for a person, a senior citizen, even if it is 60, 65, still young at heart, and he goes around world tour, enjoys gardening, golf, and pursues higher education, etc. But during Shakespeare's time, this particular time period after 45, 50, that particular time period, people would actually retire, and they would start staying at home, and physically they would be weak, and slowly they would start accepting that now they have become old, they are growing old. Okay, the last stage is described by Shakespeare as a second childhood. Okay, his youthful hopes well saved a world too wide for his shrunk shank, and his big manly voice turning again towards childish treble, pipes and whistles in his sound. Last scene of all that ends a strange, eventful history. A second childishness and mere oblivion. That is, he's not aware of anything. He's not aware of anything. And now how is he? He doesn't have teeth. His eyesight is very poor. He doesn't have a sense of taste. He's in fact without anything, without everything. He becomes totally helpless, children. He becomes totally dependent on others for everything. Okay. He wants someone to be there. There should be someone always to take care of him. So this becomes like, as Shakespeare says, it's like a second childhoodness, childishness. Okay. Where he has to, even for simple things like having his food, there should be somebody to feed him, someone to take care of him, someone to take him to the washroom. Okay. So he, like a child, becomes totally dependent and helpless. Treble, three times weaker than before. And second childishness, a return to the helpless and ignorant state of being a child. Oblivion, state of being unaware. Okay, half the time he forgets, his memory fails. So he forgets what's happening around him. Okay, many times he is not aware of the time, date, whether he has had food. So people around him, many a times it becomes difficult to tolerate a very old person. So they keep on repeating whatever they have said because they don't remember. And so here you have the extreme form of aging where man is no longer able to perform his basic tasks of bathing, eating, etc. So like a child, he becomes totally dependent on helpless. Old people in the previous time, they were treated like little children. And so Shakespeare describes this child as second childhood. To sum up, the poem has a very universal application, and the way the poem has been written with all those figures of speech decorating the entire poem, okay, and how he has stage by stage he has presented the unique feature of every single stage reveals or reflects, you can say, Shakespeare's deep understanding of human psychology. Okay, so we come to the end of the poem, children. The figures of speech are all given in the target book, the notes which have been given to you, supplied to you, and you will try and read the poem very thoroughly well. See to it that you read the poem well, and comprehension try to read the poem, revise the figures of speech. The stages are given very beautifully, and the unique feature of every stage is being asked. Since I have explained it out to you here, we're not going to do the activities again because it is given the notes that is provided to you. In case you have any doubts regarding the activities which are given, then you can put it up on the personal chat or you can put it up on the group and we can discuss it. Children, for the English portion, I've already put it up in the group that you have 1.1, two poems for the unit test. One is 1.1, Where the Mind is Without Fear, where we have this, I have explained the poem to you in another video. And now this particular poem, All the World's a Stage, two poems total. And you have the lesson, Thief Story, where again I had put up some videos for you to watch. I hope you have watched all the videos where there's line-to-line explanation and the meanings have been, again, word meanings are also discussed well in that particular video. Activities, I'll take up a revision for 1.2, the Thief Story, if possible, before the unit test. And you have Alchemy of Nature, another very beautiful lesson. Next video will be related to that particular lesson. Hope your notes are completed, and grammar portion also I have put up in the group. So try and revise all the grammar portion which we have done, and be well prepared for the test. Thank you, children. Have a nice day.